So the World Economic Forum takes place each year in Davos, Switzerland. It's located in the Swiss Alps, about 2 hours east of Zurich, right near the border with Austria.
Everybody, this is another episode of the Climate Emergency Forum, and today I have the honor of introducing and discussing and chatting with Rabbi Yonatan Narrell. Today's topic is going to be the Davos Conference, which Yonatan attended recently. We don't know too much about it, apart from what we hear from, a few mainstream media reports. But it's a yearly conference. Hopefully, we can get a better understanding of it by chatting. So welcome to the program, Yonatan.
Thank you. Good to be here with you.
Can you please tell us a little bit about your work, who you are, basically, and what you do?
Sure. So I founded and direct the Interfaith Center for Sustainable Development. We're based in Jerusalem, and we're revealing the connection between religion and ecology and mobilizing people to act. We're active in the UN climate process, and we're involved in organizing interfaith events around the UN climate conferences that take place each year. This past year in Sharm el-Sheikh, we organized 4 interfaith events that brought over 20 speakers together and made a moral call for climate action from the climate conference in Sharm el-Sheikh, Egypt.
So I have this book, which I purchased. I'm terrible with books. I tend to buy far too many and not get a chance to read them. So I have a huge list. And this is a book. It's called Davos Man, How the Billionaires Devoured the World. It's by Peter S. Goodman. He's a global economics correspondent with the New York Times. Anyway, you know, a lot of people have heard of Davos, but have really no idea what the objectives of the conference are. People have this view that it's billionaires that attend it. So maybe you can tell us a little bit about how you managed to get invited and what you thought of the conference.
Sure. So the World Economic Forum takes place each year in Davos, Switzerland. It's located in the Swiss Alps, about 2 hours east of Zurich, right near the border with Austria. And this conference has actually been going on in one form or another for 52 years. It began as the European Management Forum, and it was started around 1970 as an attempt to help European companies be competitive with United States companies that were at that time outcompeting European companies. And then in the 1980s, it changed names to being the World Economic Forum. And yes, there are billionaires there. I actually had the good fortune of interacting with a few. And there are other people there. As I understand it, there were 60 heads of state and their delegation and security personnel. There were several hundred ministers of governments, including environment ministers from a number of countries and foreign ministers and economic and trade ministers. There were about 1,500 business people who attended, mostly the CEOs of major companies. And then there were journalists, philanthropists, and people in civil society like myself. So I was part of the civil society contingent. The reason I was invited was because I believe as far back as the conference has been going on, there has been a presence of religious people and religious figures, clergy at the conference. In 2017, there were 16 senior religious figures. Cardinal Turkson of the Catholic Church attended. Rabbi David Rosen attended for a number of years. Swamis, Hindu religious figures from India attended. Muslim religious figures. So there were many senior religious figures that were attending for many years. And because of the work I do on religion and ecology and religion and climate change, I was invited and spoke at two events that were related to the conference, where I was together with other religion and ecology speakers and indigenous speakers, spoke about, you know, why faith communities should get on board in addressing the climate emergency.
So I guess the question is, I mean, we were together quite recently at the COP 27 in Egypt. I think we met through Stuart, I guess, many years before that at other COPs, the Conference of Parties, the big climate conference. So were you pleased with the discussions on the climate emergency or on climate change that you attended or heard? Like, is it definitely on the radar of people at the conference at Davos?
I would say it is. There were 263 sessions that were held connected to the conference, and I attended a number of them on climate change. Al Gore spoke, and I had the chance to interact with him briefly. He, in his speech, which I posted on my Facebook page, he spoke about the announcement that was made during the Davos World Economic Forum about how the United Arab Emirates appointed the CEO of the Abu Dhabi National Oil Company as the president of the COP process. Because the host country and the UAE is the next host in December of COP28. So they have the ability to appoint the president. And so Al Gore spoke out very strongly against that decision. And he cited a conflict of interest between an oil executive managing and being responsible for the humanity's process to curb fossil fuels. And I was very impressed by the, you know, the forcefulness with which he spoke. John Kerry was also there. I also had a meeting with the climate envoy of a major European country. So yes, climate change and is on the agenda, as is a circular economy, protecting the oceans, plastic pollution, biodiversity, the gamut of environmental issues. There were sessions devoted to each of those and multiple sessions devoted to them. So, you know, I would estimate that there were probably 40 of the 260 sessions that were devoted specifically to ecological sustainability. And in each session, let's say they had five speakers. So there were, you know, 200 speakers on this topic. And they also brought in a delegation of indigenous leaders, including the head of you know, one of the Native Americans of the United States organizations. They brought in a youth activist from Ecuador whose land oil companies have tried to drill on. You know, and so I think the conference, you know, this year and probably in recent years is different than the conference as it was in the 1980s and 1990s when it was the source of major protests.
So it's adapting as things change. Like, I mean, I understand that it's really, it can be, its focus can be on, you know, major world events that have occurred in the say the past year. I mean, I think, is that true? Do you think the agenda of the conference and the speakers, is it set far in advance, or is it, you know, is it focused also on recent things happening, recent events? Like, for example, on the Ukraine situation with, you know, the Russia-Ukraine situation, was there lots of on that topic? I'm asking a lot of different questions. Sorry, my voice is just going a bit. Let me take a swig of my drink here.
Yeah, but I'll just relate to that initial question that, yes, it is, you know, very much focused on current events. And so the First Lady of Ukraine spoke in person. President Vladimir Zelensky spoke via a video link. I got to meet the boxers, who is the mayor of Kiev. And so, you know, Ukraine was definitely on the agenda. In previous World Economic Forums, there were Russian government leaders and oligarchs who were in attendance. This year, none of them were in attendance. And I'm pretty sure because you know, of travel bans and sanctions and the World Economic Forum, I'm sure didn't invite them to attend.
So I guess, you know, with climate change, one of the biggest things that it's manifesting is all of these extreme weather events that are happening around the world in higher frequency, severity, and duration. And it doesn't, you don't have to look very far or very far back in the past in the news cycle to see some of these things. Like this year and late last year, California seems to be in the news an awful lot with the massive atmospheric rivers that are dumping lots of rain and it's flooding out lots of the state and so on. What I didn't realize, and probably most people didn't realize unless you really follow the news, is, I mean, we had tremendous numbers of tornadoes, for example, in the U.S. the last month. And, you know, those sort of things are, because they're happening more and more often, I think people are getting a bit sort of cynical about it, or they're getting, you know, if there's lots of bad news coming at you of extreme weather events, you kind of block it out, or each particular event doesn't affect your thinking and your psyche and your emotion as much as previous years because it's happening too often. I think that's part of the way the human mind adapts to these sort of things. I guess the question is, I mean, my biggest concern is the global food supply. Was food covered at the conference? Was inflation covered? Because we all hear about inflation. It's on the mind of many economic leaders, but I don't see the connections made to climate change. I mean, it's more immediate things like Ukraine, Russia. It's connected to other things and not climate change. And yet, you know, we're heading into a strong ENSO, a strong El Nino, which can greatly cause warming of the planet, you know, by up like 2.2, 0.3 degrees over a few years that it occurs. And, you know, that is a big threat to the global food supply, in my opinion. So did you hear anything much about food issues? And did you hear the term ENSO or El Nino even mentioned at the conference?
So I didn't hear those terms mentioned, although, as I said, there were 263 official sessions. And over the 5 days that I was there, I only attended a fraction of them. I was also, you know, meeting with people. But in terms of food, there were a number of sessions focused on food. I attended one of them. Part of what the World Economic Forum is trying to do is they also, the founders, Klaus and Hilda Schwab, set up the Schwab Foundation for Social Entrepreneurship. And they're trying to encourage social entrepreneurship. And so there were several entrepreneurs there who were doing businesses that are on behalf of the public, meaning their primary motive is not profit, but rather helping people. And so I had an interesting meeting with the CEO of a new initiative that's working on superfoods. His name is Derek Brett Gallo. He's the chief regenerative alchemist at Awi Superfoods, which is based in Sao Paulo, Brazil. You know, their motto is the more you're nourished, the better the river people's lives and the more the Amazon thrives. And so, you know, one of the things that he's working on is to try to promote the growing of superfoods, like I don't know which ones, but instead of, you know, cutting down the rainforests for cattle ranching and soybean production, to try to grow some of the native species that have grown in the Amazon for thousands of years, and which also happen to be, you know, very nourishing foods. You know, you might be familiar with goji berries that are grown in the Himalaya, or maca root is another example of a superfood that's grown in the Amazon. So that's one example of a conversation I had with someone who's working on this, you know, connection between food and ecology.
Yeah, that's very interesting, because one of the things that, you know, with rapid warming and also with higher CO2 levels in the atmosphere, some of the crops that we use as foods are actually having, it turns out that if they're growing faster because it's warmer and hotter, then they have less nutrient basis for. So this is becoming an issue, not just the quantity of food, but the quality of food as climate change accelerates. So locally in Davos, I mean, Davos, I'm familiar with some of the changes in the Alps, in other high mountainous regions, where less ice and snow and often thaws even at high altitude are resulting in landslides occurring in fine regions is one issue. And also, of course, much less snow covering these regions. I mean, they're changing. I mean, people know global average temperatures increase 1.2 degrees Celsius. Temperatures are rising much faster at high latitude regions at the poles. They're also rising much faster at high elevation regions, like in mountainous areas. So were there some sessions on local effects, climate change, local effects to, say, the ski industry in the Alps, things like that? Or were people worried about that?
Yeah, I think that this was mentioned. I mean, Switzerland and Europe have had a much warmer winter than usual. And Switzerland, being primarily in the Alps, has actually experienced faster warming than other places. And so this was also the case in, you could see it because on the day that I arrived on Sunday, January 15th, there wasn't much snow in the town nearby where I was staying, Closters. And it actually started snowing the afternoon that I got there. And it snowed on most of the days that I was there. But that snow in, you know, mid-January was some of the first major snow that they got. And usually they get snow in, you know, late November or December. These alpine resorts, whether in the Swiss Alps or in the Sierra Nevada of California or in Colorado, you know, the ski industry is threatened by climate change. It can be hard sometimes for people to rally, you know, around curbing climate change because it seems like such an amorphous issue and such a big issue. Perhaps it could be easier for ski enthusiasts and snowboard enthusiasts to say, you know, I can't imagine a world where I couldn't ski or snowboard or my kids couldn't ski or snowboard. And that can be a much greater motivation to people than, you know, these bigger issues of just curbing climate change.
Yes, that's actually very true and noticeable in Canada. Being in Ottawa, we have what they tout as the world's longest skating rink. Each winter, when the canal freezes over, it's many, many kilometers long. I think it's
7 or 8 kilometers
long. And people skate, and there's a winter festival in late February called Winterlude, which is based on the canal. And it hasn't frozen yet this year, and it may not until, you know, who knows if it'll even be open for the festival. So winters, I think people are experiencing different effects of climate change, especially in the northern countries, all over the world. So when we were at COP27, there was an initiative that you were involved in. Do you remember you gave us, you gave me and Charles and Heidi a banner, and it was in Hebrew, it was in Arabic, it was in English, and it was talking about, I believe it was different passages from religious books, you know, the Bible in the case of Christianity. And it was talking about issues that would have an ecological importance. Did you have those banners? I mean, what sort of things were you doing yourself to promote people to have more awareness of the ecology and of climate change and things through religious means or faith-based means?
Well, so they actually have a policy of not handing out promotional materials aside from your business card,
okay.
Which actually has the side effect of making it, you know, in terms of the paper that's printed and the material. So that's actually an ecological move. And some people didn't have business cards, but they have these new QR codes that you could just scan into your phone, and that gives, you know, their right. LinkedIn profile or their contact information. So again, I spoke at two sessions, and at one of the sessions, it was called Custodians of the Earth. It was a dinner with about 50 people, among them about 8 speakers. There was Gopal Patel, who's the founder and director of Bhumi Global, which is an organization that's been working to engage Hindu communities on ecology and is now working on ecosystem restoration with a range of communities. And there was Fawn Sharp, who's the president of the National Alliance of American Indians. There was Helena Gualinga, who's an Ecuadorian indigenous activist who works with Greta Thunberg. So, you know, part of what I was doing was talking about the connection between the Bible and ecology, partly based on the book that I co-authored called Eco Bible, an ecological commentary on the Hebrew Bible. But I was also having meetings with a number of people, some in the philanthropy world, some in media, some in business. You know, I had an interesting conversation with the CEO of Walmart, for example, about, you know, their efforts to promote more sustainable products. You know, there are millions of products on Walmart.com. And, you know, the question is, how can these major retailers help in the transition to a sustainable economy? So he was speaking on a session on the circular economy. And, you know, one of the amazing things in my experience was that because, you know, these, you know, prominent individuals were, whether they're from government or business or philanthropy, were speaking on panels. So usually at the end of a panel, I could just go up to the panelists and interact with them, you know, which was I very much enjoyed and appreciated the opportunity to have these conversations with, you know, a range of people sort of with access, you know, proximity to power and influence.
Yeah, I mean, it sounds like a wonderful place to network, to try to increase the traction and of messages on climate change and other issues. So is there a theme for each of the Davos conferences? And is there sort of a concluding statement? Is the objective of the conference just to bring all these people together to try to solve global problems? Or is it directed along a certain agenda or topic, do you think?
So there is a general framing for each year. It's called the annual meeting. This year's general framing was cooperation in a fragmented world. And, you know, it probably follows on the, you know, the war in Ukraine. It's also just interesting to note that the, you know, why is it that this conference, which is the conference in the world with sort of the most, you know, heads of state and business leaders and philanthropists, et cetera, you know, why is it taking place in Switzerland of all places in the world? Why isn't it in Ottawa, for example? Now, I mean, it partly has to do with the initiative of the founders. But, you know, if you look at Swiss history, Switzerland is an interesting place where there's actually four official languages in Switzerland. There's Italian, German, French, and Romance, which is spoken in the state where called Graubünden, where Davos is located in the Alps in eastern Switzerland. And here you have this country made up of these cantons or sort of, you know, city states that united with different languages, and they have these huge mountains between them, and they're only passable from these mountain passes that, you know, prior to the automobile, people would go by foot or by, you know, donkey or horse. And here you have in Switzerland, it's one of the highest per capita countries in the world. And here they're promoting cooperation among people in the world. And so, you know, I, as an Israeli Jew, was interacting with Muslims from many different Muslim countries that I normally don't interact with. And, you know, so I think that this reputation that it's only about, you know, billionaires sort of in the back room making deals for, you know, taking over the world, I think that that's exaggerated. In my experience, I mean, look, I'm not a billionaire trying to write backroom deals, so I can't, you know, say what was happening in the hotels on the side. But in my experience, you know, there's a lot of people of goodwill who are trying to, you know, promote a livable, sustainable planet. And that's why, you know, a lot of environment ministers show up, a lot of climate envoys show up, a lot of environmental philanthropists, you know, the heads of many of the main climate philanthropies were there and speaking at sessions and meeting with different people.
I mean, I always think of Switzerland as, you know, for two things. One is the neutrality. I mean, Switzerland is, you know, it's remained neutral it was neutral in World War II. And as a result, it can act sort of as an arbiter of Europe in a way, you know, with this neutrality when there was a conflict in the past. People, you know, or I guess they think of the watches, I guess, you know, the beautiful engineering of Swiss watches. So a very technical sort of high technical knowledge society. And then, of course, the Swiss bankers. I mean, everybody's heard of Swiss bankers, right? Mm-hmm. So hopefully one year, you know, the theme of Davos can be just basically abrupt climate system change. What can we do? How can we, you know, mitigate climate change? Is there enough money going into adaptation to help countries deal with the extreme weather? You know, the trying to make sure that we have a resilient food supply, basically how we deal with it, because we're not being very successful. I mean, today I just saw headline news this morning was the record profits at Exxon. Exxon profits were, I think, $56 billion, which far exceeded any of their previous profits. It was just released this morning. And, you know, I think we're going to see the other major oil companies follow suit and have probably record profits again. So clearly something is not working still. I mean, we're not treating climate change seriously enough. I mean, we're still using fossil fuels at record high levels, and the greenhouse gas levels in the atmosphere are still rising at record high levels. And Like if you look at all the climate metrics, they're heading the wrong way. If you look at the economic metrics, such as oil company profits, they're also heading the wrong way. So we're in a lot of problems with climate change, and it's getting worse. So, you know, I would hope maybe at some point in the future, Davos could focus mostly on those sort of issues. You know, it might not be recognizable as an economic conference. It might be more as a climate conference at some point in the future. I don't know. So we're running to the end of our time here. So do you have some concluding remarks about the conference and maybe about your hopefulness for us doing the right thing collectively as the stresses on our society, on organized civil society, civilizations, et cetera, become worse and worse?
Well, look, I agree with you that humanity is on a collision course with Earth. And I also think that climate change is just a symptom of a deeper problem, that the ecological crisis is a spiritual crisis. It's a crisis of how we live as spiritual beings in a physical reality. And so I suggested when I spoke that, you know, just like they rebranded the European Management Forum to be the World Economic Forum, so too they could rebrand it to be the World Earth Forum. Because at the end of the day, if we only expand economies, but we neglect the Earth systems, then we're not going to end up in the long run with a sustainable planet. And so that's why I was pleased to be speaking with other religious personalities and indigenous people about how do we access the millennia-old faith traditions in order to enable the next generation to inherit a livable, thriving, and spiritually aware planet. And so, you know, that's the work I'm doing in COP28, to trying to organize a religions pavilion that would highlight senior religious figures and young clergy that would have speaking roles in the main plenary and other pavilions, meet with oil executives, meet with country negotiators. I don't think that we're going to curb climate change unless religion gets on board in doing that. 85% of people in the world affiliate with a religion, and we need all hands on deck. And that includes the over 6 billion people who identify and practice a religion. So, you know, I'll just finish with a story that the Nobel laureate Toni Morrison told about a young boy who comes to an elder woman with a bird in his hands. And he says to her, "Can you tell me whether the bird in my hands is alive or dead?" And she thinks to herself, and she realizes that the boy is playing a trick. Because if she says the bird is dead, he'll open his hands and release the bird, and she'll be wrong. And if she says the bird is alive, he'll close his hands and crush the bird, and she'll also be wrong. And so she looks at the boy in the eye, and she says to him, "I don't know whether the bird in your hands is alive or dead. All I know is that the life of the bird is in your hands." And so I bless us to use the power that we have so that this can be a planet that is thriving, spiritually aware, and sustainable. Thank you.
That's a wonderful, wonderful story. I'd just like to thank somebody who's no longer with us for actually doing so much work to connect people like myself and Yonatan and many climate scientists and many, many other people that are working to fight abrupt climate system change. And that person is Stuart Scott. Stuart was instrumental in bringing me to the first COP, and that was back in 2014.
Yeah, so I started working with Stuart Scott about 12 years ago, and we were involved in organizing interfaith climate events, including at the UN Climate Conference in Durban in 2012. And I just feel like his spirit lives on in the work that we're doing, and that he's, you know, part of our spiritual crew rooting for us and helping us with the holy work that we're engaged in here.
Thank you very much for taking the time today, Yonatan, to come on and chat with us on Climate Emergency Forum.
You're welcome. Thank you.
And thank you to all the people watching and following Climate Emergency Forum. And please subscribe to our channel. Click on the subscribe button.